Stay home, really? It's Wednesday, it's rainy. Just stay home. Look at each other. You're beautiful. So we have 26 unvaccinated in the hospital, 17 vaccinated, 8 in the ICU. The CAR score, which I don't think we use anymore, is 43.8. Is that the highest?
I believe so.
What was it last year when we did the Strive for 5?
It was not in the 40s, for sure.
Okay. So, yeah. I think we need to bring back Strive for 5. Or how about bring it to zero? The people of Guam are the heroes. Bree's not in the mood. It's 8:36. It's a rough morning. Let's go ahead and get Superintendent John Fernandez on.
We also have Isaiah Uggen, one of our reporters who also covers the education beat. So, Isaiah, just feel free to jump in if you have any questions. But, John, we'll just start with you first and just giving us an update on where GDOE is in making the switch to online learning.
Well, a lot has happened since the last time we were on the show. So, you know, again, this is one of those, situations where these weekly updates are kind of important because things can change dramatically. Even on Thursday last week, you know, I think as you know, we were spending last week really reaching out internally and to our parents as well through a lot of virtual sessions. And we continue to do so this week as well. So just really touch base with our stakeholders directly, get their questions, concerns, and, you know, help get their input in terms of thinking about the future and how we wanted to proceed. So, you know, last week we were tracking the same numbers that people were tracking in the community regarding the surge in COVID-19 cases. And of course, we started to think through, you know, what are the things that we want to do? Do we want to operate status quo, and how do we feel about that? And what are the things that we know are working, and what are the challenges? We thought we also, we're talking about what if we want to, you know, what about using cohorts as a way to at least immediately try to mitigate some of the concerns that parents are bringing. You know, and then again, you know, the worst case scenario would be a full shutdown. So we were in the midst of that conversation, a lot of good discussion last week. And at the same time, we were touring schools of public health. We wanted public health to be out there with us, watching our kids, moving through the school, in the classroom, moving through common areas, so they could also provide a really good assessment of how schools were doing during the reopening during this pandemic. So at that time, public health was working with us. They were really impressed with what was happening in the schools, and of course noticing there are of course areas to strengthen and address. So, you know, things like the cafeteria or the common areas, you know, areas that we could, you know, we were working on to think through a different, you know, additional solutions to things that could be improved. So that's where we were. And on Friday, we were at Simon Sanchez doing the very same thing when we got the call from the governor. And so both Arts and Augustine and his team were at Simon Sanchez, and I was there as well. The rain came down really hard, so we ran to our cars to participate in a Zoom meeting with the governor. And when she came online, she came online to just let us know that, you know, she had decided, based on the recommendations of, I'm figuring her medical advisors and so forth, that it was time to close schools and suspend in-person learning. I had figured that, and I figured we were getting to that point because no matter how we were doing within the schools, and no matter how much we were confirming that there was no spread of the virus within the school setting, at the same time, you know, we were noticing that the community numbers were skyrocketing, which meant that the number of cases that were going to show up at the doors of our schools was just going to increase. And we had already begun talking about the impacts of having to, you know, address these individual cases. The more cases you have, you know, the more parents have to be notified, your school nurses, that full attention is on those cases, your administrators are fully activated on those cases. You know, if you have to quarantine teachers, you're looking at finding substitutes to cover the class. If you're impacting staff, then supervision of the kids. So the more cases that we have showing up, we were already noticing that this was having a secondary operational impact on schools. So again, we were at that point. We figured that at some point, the community numbers are going to be so high that we're going to have to pull the trigger on some type of mitigation measure. Now, she actually chose what we were trying to avoid, you know, the worst case scenario of having to go fully online and suspend in-person learning completely. I had asked whether there was any consideration for moving into cohorts, at least allowing, you know, half the students to come every day so we could maintain face-to-face instruction, but, you know, with lower numbers of kids on campus. But I think, you know, based on the numbers and based on the projections, I think what she said was, it's going to get worse. You know, I think we all know this. It's going to get worse before it gets better, because any restriction takes about a couple of weeks, you know, to really impact the numbers. So I think that's what we're seeing. We're seeing it get worse, but we're waiting for these restrictions or these, you know, measures to take effect and hopefully see those numbers come down. But at that time, I suggested maybe we just do half and half. But I think she felt that the situation was so urgent that even that half measure was not going to be sufficient to turn the tide in terms of, you know, bringing the numbers down. And I think also reassuring parents that the kids are not going to be at risk during this pandemic. Even if we hadn't seen spread, I think the idea was that it's only going to be a matter of time before the numbers are so high that you're not going to catch everything. And so my understanding is, even though I don't have those numbers, I think there was indication that there are kids who are getting sick and even a couple who may be requiring hospitalization. And that's really my biggest worry. I mean, in the first, you know, the first stage of COVID-19, everything we know up to July of this year, you know, everyone's been talking about COVID-19 not having as big an effect or as severe an effect on young children. But with the variant and with what we're learning from other states, you know, hospitalizations are going up for children, and you know, there's a lot we don't know. So I don't think we want to take that chance and try to second guess. But I do know that I've texted her a couple of times just saying, look, when it gets safe enough, please prioritize the reopening of schools when we can. These kids were so happy to be there. And as you know, I have a couple of kids in the school system. When I told them that, you know, we were going to suspend in-person learning, I got the biggest stink eye, you know, you could imagine, right? Well, I said, hey, I didn't decide it. It was not me.
Oh, you checked the governor. Oh, no. Go stink eye the governor.
But I told the governor, I said, you know, the kids really enjoyed being there. The older kids especially were looking forward to get back into activities. And so it's our job, it's our duty to try to figure out a way to get them back into school safely. So I think at that point, so this week, we just wanted the switch over from the end of Friday when the executive order was issued to Monday without having a chance to talk to the kids and distribute laptops and all of that. We did want to buy some time to make sure we shifted everybody over and got the laptops ready for distribution. And so this week, that's what we've been doing. I've met along with the deputies with additional meetings with elementary and middle school teachers and staff to continue to answer questions and talk through their transition. And then next week we will begin online learning for all students. all the schedules and all that information will be pushed out for these remaining 3 days of the week. So we'll provide more information to the community about what to expect. And then of course their schools will communicate directly with them as well.
Where are you with the laptop distributions and also for, I guess, Wi-Fi?
MiFi.
So the laptops are being addressed at the school level. So Anybody interested in getting a laptop now should go to their school directly and make sure they apply for a laptop, and the schools will handle it at that point. If there are any issues, the schools will then notify us at the central office to see what we can do to assist. So don't go to the central office first, because all the laptops are at the schools, and the schools will know how many that they have on hand to be able to distribute. But if there are any issues once you go to the school, then we are able to assist. So there should be laptops that can be distributed for families who need that support at this point. With regard to MiFis, the first round of MiFis have all been given out. So We are in the process of procuring additional MiFis, but at this point we are open. You know, the executive order suspends in-person learning, but as part of our discussions about that executive order, we did ask to be able to open schools for internet access. So the community learning centers and those schools that were not necessarily CLCs will all be open for internet access. So most likely they will set up a space within the cafeteria or within an area that's large enough at the school to be able to have students register and come to school to be able to access a laptop, access the school internet for the purposes of, you know, online learning. Of course, they will have to be distanced and, you know, cleaning and no food and drink and so forth. So we're working on those details with every school to assist with the internet access at the community level.
Have you heard about situations where the schools have ran out of laptops? And if so, what is the solution for parents that are in need of these laptops for their kids?
So there should be laptops available. And again, if there are laptops that are not available, that should be communicated with the central office, because we identified laptops of a certain, the laptops that were most recently purchased, right? So there may be available assets at the schools, and the schools may just need further guidance to make those available to students. So it really is a matter of if you're being told at the schools that laptops are not available, then we need to be able to address that at the central office to be able to assist. So some of the situation, I haven't heard any specific reports, but I do know that just anecdotally, there are families, let's just say large families with, you know, let's say 5 or 6 kids, and they may not be able to get one laptop for every student, but they may be able to get 2 to 3 laptops to share amongst the kids. So there may be some of that going on where, you know, some families are saying, well, we only have one laptop, but I have 5 kids, so they're coming in for additional laptops. So there may be some prioritizing and sharing that needs to go on, and that'll be decided at the school level. But I haven't heard of any schools that have run out yet, and if so, I know that we can work with them to either find laptops available at other schools or to ensure that available laptops that have not been distributed are approved to be distributed. So what I mean by that is I think we prioritize just like the last 2 or 3 years of laptops that have been purchased. But if there are working laptops that are purchased 4 years ago, we can go ahead and approve those for use. We didn't initially approve those just because we didn't want to, you know, open up the door for so many technical issues that might, you know, be associated with the older laptop. But if they're in working order and the schools can distribute them, then we're certainly going to look at approving those for distribution.
John, we have we're going to bring in Isaiah again, our education reporter.
Sure.
He has a few questions. Isaiah.
Hi, Superintendent Fernandez. You know, I guess with mail distributions or the grab-and-go distributions beginning next week, do you anticipate community learning centers, I guess, the original 21 learning centers having an impact? And will you be rerouting those schools to other locations?
So all schools. So remember, we had 21 CLCs, but we are actually having all schools, even if they weren't designated as a CLC, during working hours, we anticipate, we actually are requiring that they open up space at their schools to address internet access. So it's going to be like having 41 CLCs open. Remember, the CLCs were for after hours and weekends and so forth. What we're doing is opening up the schools within their normal operating hours to assist with internet access as well, as part of this sudden shift to online learning. So those will continue, and they shouldn't be disrupted by the grab-and-go meals. We're still working on the logistics of grab-and-go. What we will be doing is those will be at 12 hubs. This is what we did early in the pandemic. Last time it started, back in 2020 when it first started. Instead of doing meals every Friday, instead of doing non-perishable meals every Friday, which is what we eventually switched to, we will be Sodexo will be preparing lunches and lunch and breakfast meals every day for pickup by families who want to come to those 12 hubs. So we're going to start with that. That'll help Sodexo, you know, kind of address some of the inventory that would otherwise go to waste in terms of food that was purchased to be used. A lot of that has shelf life, so we want to make sure we prepare those meals. And Sodexo has the at this point, because they've hired up, you know, for full school operations, they actually have the manpower now to support the entire grab and go operation. It used to be that school staff would be required to assist with that, but now this year the school staff will not be required to assist. Sodexo will handle that entire operation, and that'll free up the school staff to do things like supervise the kids who come in for internet access and so forth. So that's the plan. And again, you know, we'll launch that next week, and we'll continue to, you know, monitor and see how that works. But Sodexo, again, is ready to help and expand its assistance now that they have their employees on board and able to work. And that'll give our staff the opportunity to focus on other things.
Okay, can you, you know, I guess students without a MiFi device or internet access, you are encouraging parents to take them to school. What is the process? Can you clarify the process of them having to register, and will they have, or when can they, I guess, start going to the schools to, I guess, seek internet access?
So the schools will provide that information to the students, and we will also put out a press release when those details are finalized. So that's actually in the process right now, but there will be a registration process, so it won't be just kids just showing up. I mean, obviously, if there's space and they come, we would like to accommodate them, but we also want to make sure that we manage, you know, the numbers of students who are able to show up at any one time. So we're going to have a registration process where they do need to sign up and let the schools know that they're going to be at, that they want to use the internet access at school, so the schools can accommodate them. We're still going to be required to follow the distancing and masking and so forth. So I think the schools just want to make sure they have sufficient space and laptops and so forth just to accommodate those students. So again, that was the process with the COCs. Now it's expanding to all schools. So we're going to need to let everybody know when to come in and how to register to sign up.
Okay. You know, this is not really COVID related with GDOE, but Ocean View Middle School, I guess, had a burglary, I believe, Monday night. Do you happen to have the details or aware of any of the information with regards to what happened?
We're aware of that there was a burglary. We're aware there was a break-in at the schools. And we know that at the time we were checking yesterday, the crime lab had just come in and done its work. And so the school is preparing a report to determine whether anything of value was missing or taken. I do think they've identified a couple of maybe not necessarily high value items that were missing, but they are looking to do a full report at the school, and we'll submit that. It's not been submitted yet to determine whether it was actually a burglary to take, you know, to target, you know, items to take from the school, or whether it was more like vandalism, which we've also seen at some schools where kids come in and break things and so forth. So we'll be getting that report shortly. But I think the last time we checked in, there were some items that seemed not necessarily high value, things that were just kind of laying around on a desk, you know, in the main office, for instance, that were it just couldn't be found. But I think they're having the teachers come in and, you know, make sure they do a better, more detailed assessment to determine whether anything of value was taken as part of that that break-in. Sometimes, you know, whoever breaks in, it may just be more vandalism, where they're coming in and they're just, you know, looking for things, and we see things, maybe food missing or something, versus equipment. So we're trying to determine that, and you know, in the final report from the teachers.
I have a question, John. I watched some of the virtual input session Saturday morning. Great job to GDOE, to yourself, and to your team. Dr. I think Erica Cruz, right?
Deputy,
right, one of the deputy superintendents. There was a question regarding special education, and I believe she said there was a meeting after that virtual input session to kind of discuss and go over what's going to be the plan to address special education students. Do you have anything to update us on with regard to that?
Yes, so we will be putting out a release today. We just finalized plans to have a virtual meeting again this coming Saturday at 9 a.m. Targeted specifically to families with students who are in the special education program. So we'll do a dedicated session for those parents because, you know, they typically have very focused questions on delivery of services to their children during, you know, during this time of going to remote learning. So we're going to dedicate that session to them so we can answer their questions. And we'll have our SPED administrators and management team there to be able to answer their questions. So that'll be again this last Saturday we're probably on for about 2.5 hours with parents. So you know we'll make the time available. And we got great turnout on Saturdays on that, you know, these past couple of Saturday parent sessions. We've gotten great turnout. So we look forward to getting that information out and parents joining us. I know it's a Saturday morning, but it seems to be the best time to get parents and be able to have time to discuss these matters.
Mm-hmm. Well, one of the other things that you had mentioned during that virtual input session was that while your team's working on this transition to online learning, one thing that you plan on focusing on is the reopening strategy and meeting with the governor, lieutenant governor. Have you had any of those discussions yet?
I have not in these first couple of days. We spent most of our time these past couple of days just kind of working with our teachers directly and kind of talking with them and getting their input. But again, there is a job ahead that we need to do is manage this transition to full remote learning. But at the same time, I think we're all committed to trying to get our kids back in school safely when we get to that point. I think there are a couple of things that we need to discuss. I mean, number one is in any strategy, I would ask and request that the governor put schools at the forefront, at the front of this strategy to see if we can get our kids back in school, not just because they need to be back in school from an academic and from a social and emotional perspective, but of course, as you've also heard, parents who are trying to get to work, who need to work as part of, you know, this broader return to business. The parents, I just read a story about a parent having to quit a job that she recently, obtained because now she has to stay home. So there has to be some thought and some commitment to prioritizing before we reopen everything else up in the community. Let's start with the schools. Let's do it in a measured way. Even if we have to come back in cohorts where we're only talking about, you know, every other day, allow us to do that, demonstrate that we can do so safely and have our kids return before we start, you know, lifting the restrictions on every other aspect of, our, you know, of society. So that's my first pitch. The second issue is we're tracking back. I'm sure you guys have done this, but you can just look, I've been doing this daily, just tracking the numbers from the JIC, and you go back to July 21st, right, where that was, I mean, such a different time just a month ago. Where we were seeing the positivity rate bound down at like 1%, and the cases that were coming in every week were, gosh, it was kind of in the teens. Now we are at 500, you know, new cases per 100,000, you know, over a 7-day period, and the positivity rate is over 10%, you know, over the past week. That puts us in a high risk situation in just a matter of weeks. I mean, so we know where we were a month ago. We did what we needed to do as a community to achieve that. And as we hit that 80% mark and all the restrictions were lifted, you just saw a rapid reverse of the situation in just a matter, again, just a matter of weeks, less than a month. We went from very, very low risk to high risk in all categories. I think that's something that really needs to be reconsidered. And again, I mean, before the schools open, we are already on that trajectory. And that means that schools opening in that period of time were just not the priority, at least in my estimation. We got to get schools back open. I hope that is prioritized above everything else. And it's not at the expense of the economy. It's that you've got to get your schools open if you're going to have any chance to open the rest of the island for a sustainable amount of time. So I'm going to have that discussion. I think the governor shares that. I mean, we've exchanged, you know, messages since the in-person, you know, since the executive order. And we'll just have further discussions. I just want to talk to them more about, you know, how we are operating, what we can do to increase and improve the safety of schools, but we have to get open once it's safe enough to do so.
And John, I wanted to ask you this because this is something we actually discussed on the show prior to the school opening, was the possibility of implementing some sort of a vaccine mandate for students. Is this something that you plan on revisiting as part of the reopening strategy, or are we beyond that?
You know, I the vaccines for students are something that I would have to rely on our public health experts. I don't like the idea of mandates for kids, right? If they're, you know, that go beyond their parents', you know, ability to have a role in that decision. So that's a tough one. I mean, that's a tough one, and I think that's something that would need to be looked at very closely from a public health standpoint and from a legal standpoint. I do understand, and I understand the basis for an employer mandate for the employees, and I've seen I've looked at those cases where that were cited in the executive order to understand the logic there, and I think that's a fair balance to require employers whose employees are on the front lines working with kids to be vaccinated, especially now that the vaccine has been approved for 16 and over. Then I'm okay with that, but the student vaccines, that's a harder question, and I think we need to really talk to parents, hear from parents as part of that discussion.
All right. Isaiah, did you have a question?
Well, I guess this is my last question. You know, with the vaccine mandate for executive branch employees, have you heard any teachers, I guess, resigning, and what is DOE planning to, I guess, trying to keep them because, you know, they have no choice but to get vaccinated?
So, number one, we have received questions from employees about the vaccine mandate and we have heard, you know, people talk about it. I haven't seen any people resigning at this point just due to the vaccine itself, or I haven't heard any of that. Of course, the deadline is September 24th, so, you know, that just maybe a matter of time. But it's a very difficult balancing act. I mean, number one is my communication with my employees is that we are covered by this executive order. This is a mandate that is required, and you are required to come into compliance. And as part of that, you are either vaccinated or you submit to weekly testing, and we're working through what that weekly testing will look like with public health. So that's an executive order, and it gives people a choice. They can get vaccinated or they can get weekly, you know, the weekly testing. And if they feel that that's not, that's not a desirable set of options, then of course, if they decide that it's not for them and they want to leave the department, that's going to be a very personal and I'm sure a difficult choice for them to make. With regard to any disciplinary action, again, it is an option for agencies to take disciplinary action. I'm not at the point of wanting to pursue disciplinary action. I really am at the point of, you know, ensuring that our employees understand what the requirements are, understand where and how to go get the vaccine, and to let them know that if they have any questions or concerns, to, you know, see a school nurse, see their medical provider to get more information prior to the deadline so that they have every opportunity to make that decision before we get to September 24th. And then we can see from there. Now, whether or not, you know, how we go from there is going to be, you know, that's a difficult question. You know, for me, looking at the safety of the schools, I want to make sure that we have an opportunity to bring kids back safely to school for face-to-face instruction. We have a lot of things that are required, right? Masking and all these other requirements. And now we have the employee vaccine mandate. So I have to weigh how critical this vaccine mandate is to being able to bring our kids back to school. And I have to say, ultimately, my priority in that situation has to be our kids. We have to bring that's our core mission, the reason why we are employed at the Department of Education, to bring our kids back safely to school. And we have to balance that, you know, as the top priority when we go into this discussion. So I think think that's all I can say to our employees. You know, there's no escape hatch. There's no loophole here. This is what's required. I believe it has legal basis. We are going to encourage you to be compliant, and you have a choice. You either get vaccinated or submit to weekly testing, and that's what's laid out there. And if that's not good enough, please talk to us. We're happy to, you know, work with you to see what we can do to convince you one way or the other that, you know, you should stick with the department and, you know, make a decision about which options work best for you. But if that doesn't work, then we'll have to deal with that situation, you know, at that time.
Thank you, John.
Thanks, John. Isaiah, thank you. We'll see you when you get in.
Wash your hands, John.
Take care, John.
Definitely. Everybody wash your hands, wear your mask, distance, do what you can. This is a crazy time, and we want to get back. We want to get back to where we were in July, and just put it that way.
Yep.
Yeah.
So really. Thanks, everybody.
Right on, John. Buy your kids a candy bar. Let's go to the phones just real quick, Matt.